All right. Hey y'all, coming to you from Jacksonville, Florida, this is GovLove, a podcast about local government brought to you by engaging local government leaders. I'm Ben Kittelson, Senior Consultant at Raftellis and GovLove co-host. We've got a great episode for you today. We're going to be talking leadership, customer service, and a whole lot more in Wauwatosa. But first, the best way to support this podcast is to become an ELGL member. Engaging Local Government Leaders is a professional association engaging the brightest minds in local government, and your membership helps support this podcast. So if you want to hear more great interviews like we've got today, go become a member today. Now, let me introduce today's guest. Melissa Cantarero Weiss is the Deputy City Administrator for the City of Wauwatosa, Wisconsin, a position she's been in since the beginning of 2022. And prior to taking on her current role, she served as the Director of Administrative Services and as the Communications Manager for Wauwatosa. She also has served as Assistant Village Manager for Sussex, Wisconsin, and as the Public Information Officer and Management Analyst, a great combo, if I've ever heard it, for Creve Coeur, Missouri. With that, Melissa, welcome to GovLove. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Awesome. So we have a tradition on the podcast to start with a lightning round to get to know our guest a little bit better and let you kind of ease into the podcast experience. So my first question for you, what was the first concert that you went to?
Alanis Morissette.
No way.
Yes.
That's great. Where at?
Houston, Texas.
Very cool. Awesome. All right. And then my next lightning round question for you. What was the last great book that you read?
We Were the Lucky Ones by Georgia Hunter. Our neighborhood associations here in Wauwatosa host an all-city read. So they pick a book every year for the goal, the whole city to read it. And then they have all these different events that happen to learn more about the book and have fun. So that's the all-city read this year, and I recommend it.
Awesome. Very cool. What kind of events are associated with the all-city read?
Author talks. There's usually cooking, if there's a recipe or something from the book, book club talks. Sometimes there's movie screenings. It depends on what the book is.
Awesome. That's mm-hmm. a very cool event. Very cool.
Mm-hmm. It is.
All right. The next layer question for you, cake or pie?
Cake. Only answer.
Yes. I'm with you. All right. Then my last layer question for you, where do you go for inspiration?
Pinterest. No, all jokes aside, I do a lot of reading and I like ELGL content for that. The Morning Buzz content, this podcast, LinkedIn. I like to connect with people working in the field and learn about their challenges and how they're rising to the occasion to solve them.
Yeah. 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 Talking with other folks, I agree with that. And reading about their experience, really. That's a good source for inspiration and to find new ideas for things.
Yep.
All right. Then one of my favorite questions I ask folks that come on the podcast is what was your path to local government? So how'd you end up in kind of the position you're in today?
Yeah. Well, I think everybody has kind of a random local government story usually. Yeah. So I have a bachelor's degree in economics and at the time thought I would go on to get my doctorate and teach. But the more I was studying economics, I realized we spent a lot of time talking about problems and not the solutions. You identify what the issues are, but you never work on what policy might move the needle. And so I decided to get my MPA, and local government was not on my radar as part of that. I did my MPA at Indiana University, and they have a really robust program where local government's just an aspect of what they teach.
Yeah.
And so I was looking at housing and the nonprofit space, economic development, and international economic development as well. And we needed an internship to graduate. And I really, for financial reasons, needed a paid internship. And I was able to obtain one at Creve Coeur, Missouri, that was paid. And a lot of the internships for the nonprofits and in housing were unpaid. Mm-hmm. And so I ended up there, and I loved my internship experience in Creve Coeur. And they called me up partway through my second year of graduate school and asked me to come back for a job that they had open. I said yes, and that's how I ended up in the local government space. And honestly, I really, really love it. but it wasn't a job I was aware of in high school or college before I got into graduate school.
Yeah, no, I can relate to that. I think similarly, until I got into grad school, I was like, what? Look, there's things other than just being an elected official.
Right.
Was there something in that internship that made you be like, hey, this is something I'm interested in and want to keep doing?
So I helped to staff the Recycling, Environment, and Beautification Committee during my internship, which was my first experience working with a group of really passionate residents who wanted to create some change in the community. I helped them with their beautification awards and touring gardens, and they had an interest in helping residents build more sustainable gardens. And I thought that was really an interesting grassroots experience. And I also got to help the Public Works Department design a playground and create an RFP to go out for it. And I think it was just kind of the myriad of different work you get to do in government. I like to be busy. I like varied work. And I think that's something that government really provides to you. And it's a lot of fun, you know, like working on a playground, having beautification awards, helping people to live their best lives every day in the communities they live in is just a tremendously rewarding experience.
Yeah, no, yeah, the variedness, I think. Yeah, well said. And then, you know, I think I mentioned it in your bio, but you've had a couple of different communications types of roles. I'm curious how you ended up kind of maybe doing that work and then how that's maybe informed or helped you kind of as you advance in your career.
So I have had communications responsibilities in every city I've worked for, and I've been with three different communities in my career. And I really think it's the hallmark of administration is good communication, good relationship building, good customer service skills. And so it has really served me well. I also think administration ends up being kind of a hub for communications and helping departments think through the work they're doing and how they need to do outreach into the community or with different departments about it. And so having those foundational skills in communications really helps you to succeed in an administration role and probably just in a management role in city government as well. So I really plug that as an opportunity for people to get involved. Even if you're thinking city management and you can find a communications internship or something to get your feet in the water, you will work with every city department. You will touch every city service. And so there's a really great opportunity to learn and grow in those roles. And so I think it's a fantastic place to start and to stay, frankly, in government work.
Yeah. No, that's a really good point, because it's not dissimilar to like working in a budget office where you're touching every department and having to see the big picture. You can't just be kind of only focused on like, I don't know, recreation programs or something. Like if you're a communications, working for like a central communications office, you have to kind of see everybody and work for everybody.
Yes. It's really the internal service departments, I think, are a tremendous amount of fun and work that's different and varied. And I enjoy that. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Well said. And I think it's interesting to think about that role doing external as also helping be a good manager for your organization too, where you've got the skills now to communicate to staff generally. I think that's a really good point too.
Yeah. And this is the largest city I've worked for here in Wauwatosa. We have over 475 employees. And so internal communications becomes such a tremendous part of what we need to do and think about with employees in different buildings and who don't interact with each other. So much of that interdepartmental communication and collaboration is really essential for our success.
Yeah. Especially as you go, that's a great point about the organization size too, because you're not just bumping into people anymore. Like you have to be more proactive about the communication as you get kind of go up in size. Interesting. All right. So for our listeners that maybe haven't been to Wauwatosa, can you maybe give them a sense of like of the city and maybe what they'd find if they visited?
Yeah. So Wauwatosa is a suburb of Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and the most adjacent suburb, inner ring suburb to it. We have 48,000 residents here at night, which makes us the 14th largest city in Wisconsin. But during the day, we have 105,000 people in our daytime population. And so that makes us the fourth largest community in the state of Wisconsin. And that's really driven by a couple things. We have a lot of businesses in the community. We're in fact home to the regional medical center for Milwaukee. And so we have Children's Hospital and the Medical College of Wisconsin and Freightert, which is one of the major hospital systems here. And so not only are people coming and going all day, but we have a huge employment base in that. And we also have a really large tourism economy here in Wauwatosa. So we have the premier mall in the state of Wisconsin and in southeast Wisconsin that welcomes hundreds of thousands of visitors a year. And then we have really quaint and charming downtown area that we call the Village, which has a European vibe to it with older historic buildings, small businesses, unique restaurants. And so Wauwatosa really is a place in the Milwaukee area that people want to come and visit. And so we have a lot of people coming and going throughout the day.
Yeah.
We have historic homes here. We have housing stock that's over 100 years old and really strong neighborhoods and a lot of neighborhood character. And so different neighborhoods are branded and they have names. We have East Town, Tosa, Pabst Park, all these different community names. And the different neighborhoods built at different times with unique and historic houses. And so it's not cookie cutter walking around Wauwatosa. You don't see the same five house designs on repeat. You'll see hundreds of different historic homes. So it's really a beautiful community to walk around in with tree lined streets and beautiful houses to look at and a lot of historic features.
Oh, well, that's fascinating, the kind of influx of both commuters that you get and then tourism. How does that kind of maybe impact the work of the town? Like, does that impact planning or public works in a way that, like, maybe if you didn't have that influx of employment centers or tourism that, like, that you wouldn't have to deal with? Or is there anything that, I don't know, sticks out of having that?
Yeah. So really, I think a lot of our departments are doing work well above community or population size.
Yeah.
So that impacts who we hire, who we bring in, and the services we provide. Definitely police, fire, planning, engineering, public health. They are working on items that a similar sized 48,000 people community without this employment center wouldn't be contributing to.
Yeah.
So certainly that is very impactful on our services. And sets us apart from other communities in the area. We also have a number of hotels, and so that's different than some of our surrounding neighbors. And so we actually have a tourism function, which I also oversee here, which is for where I think all the fun happens in government. Yeah. Tourism is really, it's fun work. State law requires that we spend hotel motel tax revenue primarily on marketing Wauwatosa as a destination for tourists. And so, you know, we're always talking about creating experiences for people and marketing the great things in this community and how we can have Wauwatosa be on the map as the destination for public art in Wisconsin and in the Midwest. And so we're doing a lot of fun and creative stuff in that sphere. Mm-hmm. And a lot of that is driven by our population size, our tourists, and our visitors.
Huh. Very cool. Awesome. And before we get into maybe some of the specifics, so I'm curious, you know, a deputy administrator, deputy, you know, manager, that role can look different place to place. So you mentioned tourism as being one of your kind of areas of responsibility. What are the other things that you're tasked with in that role?
Sure. So I have a suite of departments that report up to me, and that is city clerk, assessor, information services, human resources, the city attorney's office, communications, and tourism. So I spend a lot of time supporting those departments on their initiatives and helping them carry them off. Communications and tourism, I also serve as the department director for, so I spend more time on those service areas than I do on others. And then on behalf of the city administrator's office, I lead the strategic planning for the city, the implementation of that, some special projects, which I always think is really fun, including customer service. And I oversee crossing guards, which is kind of a random service that's assigned to my area. So just kind of a variety of different special projects within that administration function, which, again, fills my great desire to have variety in what I work on.
Yeah, something different each day.
With that. Yep, yeah. That's what I love.
That's awesome. Perfect. And that was a great transition to one of my questions was about the city's strategic plan. And so maybe at a high level, can you give us a sense of you guys' plan, maybe some of the focus areas, and then talk about kind of how you guys are working to implement or operationalize it?
Yeah. So we had a very large turnover of our common council at the same time that we needed to kick off a new strategic plan for the city. So that was really great timing, because when you're welcoming a majority of new elected officials, a really wonderful way to start that is listening to them and listening to the community and hearing what it is that they want for the future. So that was a fantastic opportunity for us in 2022 to develop a new strategic plan. And we rewrote our vision, mission, and organizational values, which really drives what we do every single day in our service provision. And in addition to that, we established 5 priorities. And I would say we weren't surprised by the priorities of what we heard from the community or the elected officials, which is great. Yeah. That means our staff knows what's going on in the community and what people want to focus on. One of the interesting things that we have 5 priority areas in our strategic plan. And one of the interesting things that came out of it was one of them is economic development and financial resilience coupled together. Mm-hmm. And this is the first time we've had a council that have put those 2 items together. But of course, in the state of Wisconsin, we are a property tax-based community, and we have what's called levy limits. And so we can only raise our budget in a given year by the amount of net new construction in the previous year or the amount of development that has occurred in the community the previous year. And so development's very important. We are a built out community. And so, you know, it's challenging. It's something that our neighbors and our residents really feel when there's development going on. So that was an interesting outcome that came out of that, that our council recognized that those are linked so strongly and importantly that they put those together. Our other priorities are public safety, infrastructure, housing, and quality of life. So I think, you know, as you kind of think through those, the bread and butter of government services, the basics of what we do, but how can we innovate within them and take them to the next level of service became our question. Mm-hmm. So the council set those priorities, and we actually had 2 workshops with them, and they also set goals for us, which is great. High level, 20,000 feet up in the air. And then we as a staff took that and worked with it for several months to develop an implementation plan. Mm-hmm. And so that's really where our work will continue into the future. But a few really interesting things, I think, outside of just the economic development and financial resilience from the strategic plan, we're looking at quality of life in terms of ecological improvements, climate adaptation improvements that we can make. Yeah. And so one of the items we have underway is actually building a new park in the city on the west side of town, which doesn't have a city park in it. And so that's a really great opportunity for us to build out a beautiful green space and some active play and less active play for the community that we are working on right now.
Very cool. That's awesome. Well, and I do like that idea of connecting the tourism and economic development with the financial resiliency. So when you get into that focus area, like what are maybe some of the, I don't know, initiatives or some of the things you're working on underneath that? What do those look like when you're connecting those 2 kind of concepts together?
So we are looking for ways to ensure that we are a hub for economic diversity and innovation. Yeah. That's, you know, one thing we're looking at. So what's the mix of businesses that we have here? Mm-hmm. We do have a business incubator in the community that's a partnership with the University of Wisconsin. And so, and with the regional medical college here and the campus. There is a lot of innovation in businesses that happens here and technology businesses that locate here. And so how can we continue to support the growth in that area is very important for us and our planning and economic development staff. We also really do want to promote and support our local businesses and our anchor institutions as well. We really pride ourselves on, you know, we've got the premier mall in Southeast Wisconsin. So those are big name retail, Nordstrom's, you know, Crate and Barrel, the Container Store, things like that. But then we also have small businesses that our residents have opened and run in this community that really provide something unique. And so we want to be sure to be promoting and supporting both sets, which is really different. But we look at this from both an internal perspective of, you know, what kind of communication and support do they need? Licensing, business improvements, facade improvements, signs, that kind of thing. You know, we have loan programs and grant programs and things like that available. So how are we making sure they're aware of that? And then on the tourism side, how do we market that to people, not only our residents in the community, but daytime trip visitors and overnight visitors to ensure that they know what's here and that they get out and visit those businesses? And that's really what for a lot of our small businesses is driving their success, is not only having consistent shoppers within our community, but dollars outside of the community coming in to support them as well.
That's fascinating. Very cool. And is there like, how do you connect then that to like the financial resilience? Is there like a measure that you look at to be like this shows that like, hey, the work we're doing over here is helping us, you know, with that financial piece?
Yeah. So we look at net new construction. We look at building permit pulls for commercial properties and things like that. The number of small businesses that are started in a given year. And then we also like to look at the diversity of those businesses. You know, what is woman owned? What is minority owned? And how are we helping people who may have barriers to entry in the market really establish themselves? And how can we support them? For any small business, but particularly for those with barriers to entry, you know, how can we review our processes to establish a business in the community and help people figure it out? Because government's not always easy to access. You know, we've got, everybody has bureaucracy, not just Wauwatosa. So how can we look at that and help people work through that to establish themselves here?
Very cool. Very cool. Well, it sounded like you did some community engagement along with, you know, engaging with the elected officials as well. So what was that community engagement component like? It is always good to see what staff thinks and what the community thinks are in alignment. But I'm curious how you kind of heard from your community.
Yeah, so we held some kind of open house workshops, and we did some in the evening and some on the weekend, because I think we all know that this way of doing business of saying that like public comment is open at 7 p.m. on a Tuesday night is the way of the past. So the other thing we did is a lot of online engagement, and we're finding that to be very effective here, where, you know, a resident or a business owner can access the planning project or the strategic planning process or our comprehensive planning process from their phone and provide us with input and comment. And they can do that from wherever they are. So if that's at the airport as they're traveling, if that's on the side of the soccer field as you're waiting for your kids' practice to finish up, you know, you can access your city government and share your input with us, and we want to hear it. So we're trying to think about ways to expand our ability to outreach people. We did have decent turnout at some of our open houses, but I think we really are seeing high levels of turnout and input from more digital strategies.
Yeah. Well, I think when I went to your website, I saw that you guys are in the middle of collecting input for the new comp plan that you mentioned. Where are you guys at in that process? What's under any big changes under review or under consideration?
Yeah. So, you know, back to our strategic plan, really our common council asked us to consider, being a built out community, how we can balance economic development with neighborhood preservation. And that's a goal that they set for us. We were coming up on a council that wanted us to redo our comprehensive plan as well. And so that was an outcome that we set. And we know that listening to our neighbors is really important as part of that process and hearing from our residents. So we have done a round of kind of open houses with that. We do have a steering committee that has some common council members and some plan commission members that are leading that initiative. And so they have meetings, they have round tables and some charrettes and those traditional methods. We've had some open houses. But where we've had a ton of luck has been two digital tools. And one's just a survey that we have open with some questions that we're collecting information from people. And the other is a mapping tool. So people can get in there and drop a point in the map of Wauwatosa and tell us what they want to about that area. So that might be, there's not enough trees in this area. I can't access a park here. Transportation is difficult, you know, in a certain area. Or I don't like the congestion here. I don't think you should have more development in this corridor. Here's another place where I think we could have multifamily development. And so we're getting a lot of points dropped into that map, and people seem to be enjoying that spatial way of sharing information with us.
Yeah,
we've had over 1,000 responses to our online survey at this point, which for us is a very robust response. And we're trying to be targeted. So I actually dropped in on three classes at one of our high schools last week and talked about comprehensive planning, local government, because we didn't have any youth voices at the table, which it's pretty common in government. Yeah. 18 and younger is not really engaged or involved in it. But they're 16% of our population here. And frankly, they're who we're planning for. You know, 25 years from now, do they want to live here? Is this a community that appeals to them? And so we really did want to hear from them and get them involved too.
Yeah. Any great ideas from the high schoolers that you talked to?
Not in the classes that I was in, but one of the teachers assigned the survey to them in class. So they sat in there and filled it out. And so I'm excited to see the data that comes back. And what their feedback is. And it's great to have strong partnerships with the teachers in the community because that's something we can really leverage for positive engagement results.
A way to engage, and also a way to share, you know, to your point at the beginning, and like, these are career paths, you know, you can work for your local government, right?
Yeah, we talked about that because I think a lot of times people think about police and fire. And they think about garbage. You know, when you ask what city services there are, those are always the answers I get from classes. But they don't know that we hire electricians and we have engineers that work here and landscape architects and attorneys. And so there's just kind of that myriad of other services that might make people think about it, about service.
Well said. And so one thing I wanted to be sure to talk about with you was you wrote a recent Morning Buzz article for ELGL on customer service and creating kind of a customer service culture in Wauwatosa. So maybe, you know, I've got some more specific questions, but I'm curious at a high level, why do you think that's kind of important? Why did you want to focus on this in Wauwatosa?
So in my internship, when I was first engaging with local government, I met some colleagues there who were kind of curmudgeonly about service. And I want to say it's a great community and the manager the leadership doesn't share that philosophy. But you know, that traditional comment that sometimes you hear of they don't have another choice. You know, are they really going to move? And that really was a polarizing comment for me. I had worked previously both in nonprofit space and private sector, but not in government. And that's just not part of the philosophy in my mind of how we serve people when we're at work. And it really got me thinking about, well, what if that wasn't the way that we handled service? What if we strive to provide the best experience at every turn that a resident or a business owner or a customer could have with the city? What if we made city government so transparent that people could understand what we're talking about? What the heck does that agenda item mean? You know, could we write that in plain language in a way that somebody really understands what it is and knows how to give their feedback on it in a way that makes sense to the elected officials and to the staff at the government? And so that's really what started my drive for this. And I have since worked on customer service at every city that I have been at. And when I got to Wauwatosa, it was something that came up in my interview, came up as something we needed to work on in my first year here at the city. And so I really dug into it. And we had listening sessions with our employees where they came in and talked to us about their challenging customer service encounters, how they think they're perceived in the community, how they would like to be perceived in the community, and what areas they needed help. And it was really interesting to listen to the staff because, you know, when you ask your employees those questions, tell us about a difficult customer service interaction you had and how that resident perceived you and how would you like to be perceived by them, they'll give you great information and answers. Yeah. And everybody wants their residents to see them as knowledgeable and helpful and, you know, all of the great things that we all want. But we do know in government that sometimes we have to say no. Sometimes we are writing orders, you know, in the health department or in the building department or police department. So we're enforcing something. But I really think it's not in the what we're doing, but the how we're doing it. So how can we have a better experience for them? How can we really explain the why is something I talk about a lot. The why behind it. The ordinance says you can't do that. Well, what? But why? Tell me more. Like, what is it about having a retaining wall in the right-of-way that causes problems for a neighbor or for the city? What is it about the fact that your trees are blocking the vision triangle that causes problems for pedestrians, instead of just telling someone they need to trim their trees that they don't want to trim? How can we help them understand the experience their neighbors are having? So in listening with our employees, we then created a customer service team, which was interdepartmental and leadership at all levels of the organization. So we took all the feedback we heard from our employees and we created a list of customer service values that we heard and that resonated for the entire city. And then we went to the work of really defining them, because what we heard over and over again from our staff in the listening sessions was, it's great for you to tell me to provide service excellence or you know, exceptional customer service at every turn. But what does that mean? I'm a building inspector. And what does that mean for me? How do I do that? I want to do it, but I don't know how. And so we kind of took the time, and it was really helpful to have representation from police and from fire and from public works talking through some of these things with us, because it looks different in different departments. And so we came up with a bulleted list for every value, every customer service value, to explain that. And that's really what we focus our time on, is helping people understand what that means. And, you know, I really think that that's empathetic for our employees, because you know, you're asking people to do something, and if they don't know how to meet the target, that's not really fair to them. And so it's about building in that training and that mutual understanding.
Well, and to your point, like, good customer service for a police officer, and a, you know, a permit tech that's taking payment at a front counter, it's going to look different. And so, yeah, being able to define that for their jobs, it's super important. So I'm curious, so first, just to back up a little bit, so how did you engage kind of employees around customer service? Was that like a survey, or like, how did you kind of get that feedback around what?
We went out and had listening, in-person listening sessions at the different buildings in the city with employees. And so we did kind of a World Cafe engagement style with them, where you ask three questions, and the first question is kind of a softball, and then you get into some meatier questions, and the groups reported out. So, you know, we did a robust amount of listening. And everything kind of coalesced around these five values that we ended up with. We just kept hearing the same themes repeated over and over again from our employees.
And then, so, and now that you have those themes, how are you how did you roll that out to the organization? And then how are you kind of maybe training new staff as they come in on kind of those focus areas?
Yeah. So really probably I'm going to say something so government-y. It's a five-pronged approach, but we think about it kind of at hiring. So yeah. Are we bringing people into the organization that share a passion for customer service? And that's really been a focus for the city in the last 5 years. And so across the board, we have people who want to work for us and who are applying for jobs here who really value service and have service hearts. And so that I think is very important. And then we talk about it in onboarding a lot. Here's our customer service expectations. Here's what they mean. Here's how you can deliver this in your department. Mm-hmm. Training is really important. I think it's an area we need to continue to build out. We've got some room for improvement there. Mm-hmm. So right now we've been doing so much of our training through kind of articles and things that we put onto our intranet site. Mm-hmm. And like any government, we have a lot of employees who work different shifts. You know, fire works 24-hour shifts, police works different shifts than business hours. And so it's hard to reach everyone, mm-hmm. Which is why we've leaned into that model. But we also provide some toolkits for departments to take into their department meetings. Mm-hmm. So here's a question to talk about, or could you talk about the value of how to be resourceful in your department with something that's coming up? So for example, if it's a busy time of year coming up because property tax collection is about to happen, how could you break down a value that would be beneficial? Can you talk about how to practice empathy at that time with your staff? Because we know we're going to have people coming in who are confused about how property taxes work or who are struggling to make the payment. And so what are some ways that you guys could roundtable practicing empathy during that time? Mm-hmm. But we're going to start doing more training in person coming up in 2024 that's led by in combination HR and communications team, because I think people are hungry for more interaction and more interdepartmental interaction to discuss customer service. We have it embedded in our performance evaluations. So we took these values and we put them in our performance evaluations, and customer service is a competency that employees are evaluated against every year. And the definitions of that performance competency are the values and the statements of how you accomplish them. And so we embedded it right in there. And then finally, we celebrate. So, you know, how active are you in talking about things you want to change your culture around really drives your success, in my mind. And so we have customer service awards, mm-hmm. and we open it up every quarter for any employee to nominate someone else that they have seen provide outstanding customer service. And they actually have to identify at least one customer service value that they thought they saw someone excelling at and describe to us how they went above and beyond in it. And so we get applications from supervisors and coworkers and different departments and select one or two people every quarter. Oh, wow. We surprise them at their work with a customer service all-star coffee mug award, and you know, they get a photo opportunity, and then we write about that on our intranet. So like, here's an example of our office assistant, Mary, in the last quarter, and an engineer, Jen, who won the customer service award, smiling with their leadership team, the city administrator, and so on. And we tell the story of what they did so that as employees read that, they are also learning something from it. And we are pretty intentional about carrying that through to the intranet with a picture, because our analytics on our website show that our employees are much more likely to click through on articles about their coworkers and articles that have pictures of their coworkers. And so, you know, we get higher clicks on that than we do on training materials. And so we really use it as an opportunity to not only celebrate success, but teach people a real life scenario that went exceptionally well. And so they can think about how they might replicate that in their own work.
Yeah. That's awesome. And that's a really comprehensive way to like integrate it into the organization. So, I mean, it seems like a huge lift to get it into people's performance evaluations and like as part of the including hiring and onboarding. So how did you get that buy-in amongst kind of the maybe the leadership that like, hey, that we got to integrate this in this way to like truly build that culture?
Well, I think that the leadership team was hungry for some change in those areas. Yeah. The performance evaluation system itself was a little clunky and wasn't probably meeting the times. And so we first did this customer service project because they kept bringing it up. I kept hearing it from the manager and other leaders, and I was new here. So I'm passionate about customer service. It's like, I can help with this.
Yeah.
And so I ran with that project, and then we had our new HR director start with the city, and she's very passionate about performance management and employee engagement and development. And so she and I have partnered on some of these projects together to really integrate these functions and create the best outcome I think we can have for our organization. So, but we did, you know, have to go slowly. I would say the customer service project and the performance evaluations projects each took probably over a year from start to finish. Yeah. So, you know, we have a strategic leadership team, which is a smaller subset of our department directors. So we engaged with them frequently to talk about the issues we were having, some solutions we were thinking of. They give great feedback. They're a great kind of sounding board to bounce things off of. So that really helped us get good projects put together. But then it was about employee engagement and talking with every department. And we did a similar process with our performance evaluation systems, where we had representation from every department helping us to craft the performance standards for the city. What do they look like, and how do we ensure they apply to every function and every department in a way that makes sense and makes sense to our employees? So that's kind of how we go through and have succeeded, I would say, in some major change management. When I look back, getting these values established, having a new mission, vision, and values for the organization as a whole that bleeds down into all of this, and new performance standards has really changed the way that we operate as an organization. Mm-hmm. And it's not something you want to short your work time on and your engagement on to get to your outcome. But so that's how we've approached it.
That's awesome. Yeah. So you mentioned that, you know, you get nominations from folks about like success stories, and what's kind of been the reaction or the feedback from staff? You know, obviously you engage them as part of this, but I'm just curious now that it's kind of, you're more implemented and highlighting kind of success stories, what's been that kind of reaction?
They like it. You know, people like to win a customer service award and be appreciated for their work. And we try to make it really specific, because I think a thank you, you've been a hard worker, this year kind of falls on deaf ears a little bit. But when you can very specifically say, I want to recognize the time that you helped a customer navigate this very specific issue with their property with such grace, and you went above and beyond and found solutions to help them learn how to use Zoom and, you know, all the things to engage in a public meeting. It's meaningful to people. Yeah. They read that. The employee themselves feels special, but other employees read it and they're like, that's incredible. It tugs the heartstring when you see the stories. So that's been really great. The one note that we've received, and this is leading us to some changes for 2024, is that we read that, but what we really want to do is gather together and talk about our customer service experiences. So we're going to gather some examples from departments and host a series of roundtables training that people can attend, where we're going to give a table, an actual customer service scenario that happened in a department that was challenging, and allow them to brainstorm how they would handle it and kind of share out to the group so we can provide some feedback and work together to collaboratively think about how we would improve. Because our departments, everybody's got unique things, and some customer service moments are very stressful and very challenging to solve. And so I think kind of gathering as a group and supporting each other through that will be a way we can move the needle next year.
Yeah. Well, and then, I mean, And a great way to train for scenarios that may not happen very often, but are really difficult, right? Like that's to think through, like, hey, this is a challenging customer service interaction. Like, what would you do? And that's a good approach. That's really cool.
Yeah. Yeah. We're excited about it. We have a lot now where, you know, sometimes as calls escalate, it'll get to a management level. And so I see a lot of this happening naturally where a colleague will stop in and say, gosh, could you debrief this with me?
Yeah.
I had a resident with fill in the blank and I feel like I wanted to be able to offer more or do more or handle it differently. And so the more it's kind of percolated up, we could help everyone by establishing these opportunities to talk together.
Yeah. 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 Very cool. Awesome. All right. Well, and then, you know, in prepping for this interview, I saw that you guys are about to adopt your 2024 budget. So I'd be a bad former budget analyst if I didn't ask about that. So I'm just curious, you know, what are maybe some of the new initiatives or highlights from the budget as you guys are kind of rounding the bend to adopt it.
Yeah. So, this is a year where I would say the primary focus of the budget outside of our core service provision is really about mental health services in the community and honestly also with our staff. So we have built out through our health department some social work programs. So we have a social worker who supports our police and fire teams and works with them. They refer cases and the social worker can help them work through the system or help resolve an issue that's really not a policing issue or a EMS issue or a fire issue, but, you know, people need help and they don't have a place to go. Mm-hmm. And so that's been successful for us. And we're looking on continuing to expand and provide those services as best we can. A couple examples internally of mental health services that we're thinking of that I'm excited about are we have a new facility dog that we're budgeting for in 2024.
Awesome.
Yep. And so this is like a service dog, but for mental health well-being. And the primary handlers are social worker in the health department, but the dog will visit our fire stations and our police department and be able to spend time in those buildings. And I think working in this line of work, you listen to the stories of the calls that our firefighters go on, our police officers go on, and there's no doubt in my mind that those are very difficult experiences that they have on a given day.
Yeah.
And, you know, when the phone rings and they're dispatched to something, it can be anything from a very small issue to something that's traumatizing to serve. Yeah. And so the goal in the facility dog is to really have them there to help, you know, dogs like improve people's mental well-being and bring down pressure and reduce stress and can be present when they talk with colleagues about the calls that they've been on. And so we're really excited about that. And I think it's a program that more and more police, fire, and health departments are taking advantage of across the United States. I know here in the Milwaukee region, there's a few departments getting one this year. The other thing we're doing is last year we started at our chief of police request a mental health check-in for every employee at the police department. You know, it's been a challenging couple years to work in law enforcement. And so I thought that was a really good request that he had out of care and regard for his employees. And so moving forward in the 2024 budget, we are going to establish a mental wellness check-in for every officer as they come off of field training and every employee actually at kind of that same 9-month mark. So that's about when they come off of field training and before they proceed to working on their own more independently in the community. And so not only is it a check-in to see how things are going and how training has gone, but also really gives them an understanding of the services that we have available here for employees. Yeah. How many visits do we have at the EAP? What kind of counseling resources are available? What kind of peer resources are available? And so we're excited about that. In terms of things we're providing for the residents in this budget, we've got a resident survey going in 2024. We try to do one every 5 years. Mm-hmm. So that's a statistically valid survey that we contract for that gives us a sense of sentiment in a variety of areas in the community about our services as a government. And
cool.
We're excited for that. All good things start with listening. So we like to start with that. And then we're working on a new customer service model for City Hall, which I am, of course, very excited about. Yeah. We have a lot of front counters at City Hall. Like every department has their own front counter. So we're considering how we can create a welcome desk, a check-in station where people can stop right at the front of City Hall and conduct, you know, say 80% of the business they might need to in the city without having to wander around and find the right office to help them.
Awesome. Yeah, rather than wandering desk to desk. Yeah.
Right. So that's what's coming in our budget, and we're really excited about it.
Awesome. Awesome. Very cool. So we'll be sure to link to kind of the articles we talked about and some of the stuff you guys have on your website. But that's really cool, the focus on mental health, especially on public safety. And, you know, the first City Hall selfie with the facility dog you can get. I mean, that's we might have to frame that.
Yes, we should. When the dog is coming through a nonprofit in the community that trains facility dogs, and whenever a picture is circulated, it's very popular.
Yeah, that's awesome. Cool. Well, what's next? I mean, you mentioned the budget and some of the things we could look out for, but is there anything else you're working on that you want to highlight that our listeners can follow you and look out for?
So I think the two big things that are coming are this kind of new model of customer service here at City Hall that will be transformative for us. And so again, we're doing kind of a slow and steady survey and study of the issues. And in 2024, I'll be rolling out this new model, and I'll be excited to share back about that. I think it's going to be transformative for our residents and our employees here at the city. And then we are also in the process of exploring renovations to our library and City Hall over the next couple years for how we can provide the best service possible. Our library is the most visited library in all of Milwaukee County. Here. And so it's a very popular service, and it's time for some upgrades there in particular. So those are two big things coming our way.
Very cool. Awesome. All right. Then my last question for you, if you could be the GovLove DJ, what song would you pick as the exit music for this episode?
Don't Stop Believing.
Awesome.
Everyone can have customer service excellence.
Yeah. Perfect. Great pick. And awesome. That ends our episode for today. Melissa, thank you so much for coming on and talking with me and sharing all the great work you're doing in Wauwatosa. I really appreciate it.
Oh, thanks so much for having me. This was great.
Awesome. And for our listeners, GovLove is brought to you by Engaging Local Government Leaders. And the best way to support GovLove is to become an ELGL member. You can reach us online at elgl.org/govlove or on Twitter at the handle @GovLovePodcast. And subscribe to GovLove on your favorite podcast app. And if you're already subscribed, go tell a friend or colleague about this podcast and rate it 5 stars. Help us spread the word that GovLove is the go-to place for local government stories. With that, thank you for listening. This has been GovLove, a podcast about local government.